Mr. Rogers, is Mr. Rogers from Pittsburgh?
My favorite jazz musician.
He is from Pittsburgh. He did write his own music. You can, don't diss Mr. Rogers.
Dang, Sean.
He did everything.
Yeah.
I think he jammed with Seven Dust.
Yeah, totally.
Talk about a mashup.
Welcome to I'd Buy That for a Dollar, a podcast about inexpensive, common, and underappreciated records that are waiting to be rediscovered. I'm your host, Sean Hartman, and as many have found out, I want those who get to know me to subscribe to my podcast or become my enemies.
Yeah, that's the way to do it.
Don't ask for much.
Well, I'm co-host Jeremy. I don't know which side I fall on there, Sean, because I got to tell you, I'm kind of having an identity crisis.
Oh, no.
I'm getting older,
mm-hmm.
but I still like to go to these punk rock shows, and I go, and the kids, they ask me, you don't drink, you don't smoke, what do you do? And I don't know.
You're just a goody two-shoes.
Maybe.
Well, I am co-host Peter Cook, and I just have to say that it's a shame the XTC albums are just a little too pricey to feature on our program, because we could have done another one of those showdowns like we did with the Battle of the Leons at the end of season 4 when we had Leon Redbone pitted against Leon Russell. We could have done that with XTC versus Adam Ant.
Wait, what?
Are you telling me none of you are familiar with the They Might Be Giants song XTC versus Adam Ant?
Of course I'm not. I don't listen to that band.
It's all about how they're fighting for their place in rock and roll.
Okay.
Just when you think it's finished, with XTC on top, Ant music, like a phoenix, flies back up the charts.
Cool.
That went over about as well as I expected it to.
I'm sure there's some listeners that are very, very happy for that, but unfortunately, both of your co-hosts have let you down.
I have to say, my friend Nate Hartman, who's a listener, he is the biggest They Might Be Giants fan I know, and he asked if I was going to make a reference to that song, and he's like, yeah, that's probably in their top 10 worst songs of all time. So...
Well, thank you for the synopsis on the song. I don't need to ever hear it now.
You're good. Trust me, you're good. Our guest today was the co-host of the Dinner Party Download radio show and podcast, and has written for television and print media, including the New York Times, and is currently the writer, editor, and host of the Movie Podcast, an audio documentary series about great cinema currently in its 5th season. Welcome to I'd Buy That for a Dollar, Rico Galliano.
I am so honored to be here and to have been privy to all those jokes / puns / failures.
It was all those things and more. Well, Rico, I think we've already given away what we're talking about today, but why don't you go ahead and introduce the album anyway?
Yeah, which XTC album did you pick?
No, we can't feature those.
No, oh, that's too bad. I picked neither an XTC album nor They Might Be Giants album, though I'm fans of both. I picked Adam Ant's Friend or Foe, his first solo album from, I believe, I should have written this down. Is it 1982?
Or you are 80? Correct. You got
1982.
It.
1982. A good year for New Wave. An album that I bought probably not too long after it came out, with which I was obsessed as a kid. And it's one of the few albums that I think at least sonically still, well, not the few albums, I'm going to take that way back. But it is definitely an album that seemed kind of teeny bopperish at the time. And in re-listening to it, feels more artful as the years go on. I feel like at the time, I felt like there was something like unusual and original about it. And I still do. That's just like not much else sounds like Adam and the Ant, although there is one band that I'm sure we'll get into that sounds almost exactly like Adam and the Ant for reasons we'll talk about.
Yeah, excited to talk about this album. What song did we want to play first to give people a taste of that unusual and unique sound before we go further?
Well, what was referenced in one of the earlier gags was the big hit, of course, Goody Two Shoes. So let's not play that, because if anybody knows any song off this album, it's that one. But let's do the title cut, which I believe was also released as a single, but I think is maybe less, you know, play it on classic radio or, you know, quote unquote classic radio. That would be the title track, Friend or Foe.
Indeed. Side A, track one.
Right off the bat, it's just like, for a young guy, it was like, what is going on here? So you've got the, oh man, I wish that we were listening to it right now, because it's like almost every few seconds something drops in that's like, what are all these things doing together? It starts with the sound of like, and I think interestingly, starts with the sound of like an orchestra tuning up, because it's almost like preparing you for the fact that they're going to have an orchestra's worth of influences in this whole album, and a lot of them are going to show up within like the next 15 seconds.
Yeah, and I also think of this band as having a very theatrical sound, so having that kind of fanfare intro makes a lot of sense for the art that they're presenting to you.
Yeah, certainly. If you those who don't know what they look like, just go and find a, you know, type in Adamant into an image search on Google, and you'll see they are a fairly stagey band.
Yes.
They look like a bunch of dandies crossed with pirates. But then there's that, and then there's the horn section that comes in, this kind of like soul music horn section. And then the guitar sound is something straight out of a rockabilly song or a spaghetti western. And it's like, what are all these things doing together?
Yeah, and the Burundi drums.
That's, of course, the main thing that is the basis of this. I don't know if you want me to get into the Burundi drums or if you want to get into the Burundi drums.
If we want to right now, we can. I was going to plan to mention them in the bio, but they're a huge component of the sound.
Yeah, let's just leave it at that for now. But yeah, then underneath all this kind of tribal thumping drums, that is just, all of it is just, by the way, I feel like cranked up for maximum excitement. It's just like every few seconds it drops in some new thing that is unexpected and cool and hurtling, this like feeling of like intense energy that's coming from it. Plus Adam's vocals, which are very, what's the word I'm using? The kind of yelping vocal style that he has. It's both very smooth and very winning kind of crooner voice that sounds very seductive. And he's actually talking about seduction. But then also these kind of like pirate yelps that he throws in just for fun. It's just like, to me, this song is just a party right off the bat.
You had mentioned the rockabilly influence on the guitar sound of this record. And the more I listened to it, the more I was starting to think that there's a distinct rockabilly influence on Adam's vocals. That yelping and the way he will like raise the pitch at the end of some words and kind of have these rhythmic, almost like stuttering points. Like there's some definite like Buddy Holly influence going on there.
Yeah, that kind of country style. I hadn't actually thought of that. To me, when I've thought about, because this is Adam's solo album, his first solo album. Before this, he had with some of the same members of the band, a band called Adam and the Ants. And that style was evident in that too. And for some reason, maybe because of the visual image that they present, I thought of it as being somehow part of this like highwayman pirate thing, like some sort of sea shanty sound somehow, this kind of high yelping.
That's definitely the image thing they're putting out there. Yeah.
Yeah. But it actually doesn't make sense. I don't know that there's like a lot of pirates going, you know, like kind of stuff. It seems somehow right though. I don't know, but that's really fascinating. Yeah. Country sound, which we'll get, there's a song that we'll talk about later that's like more countrified.
I was mostly familiar with the Kings of the Wild Frontier album, which is an Adam and the Ants album, a pretty popular one. That's where they really broke big on that album. And so this was new to me, but it sounded familiar.
That's for sure. I mean, they're big. I don't think it's on that album, but maybe it is. Maybe it's Prince Charming that has Stand and Deliver.
Yeah, that's on Prince Charming.
That's on Prince Charming. I feel like that song could belong on this album. And I think, yeah, stuff from his, from the one you mentioned could also work here. I think it's always funny when a guy goes solo and really doesn't change the sound at all. That's kind of what's going on here.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, he did have his biggest hit in the United States once he went solo with the aforementioned Goody Two Shoes. But yeah, they're really, it feels like just a continuation of what he was doing with the Ants.
Indeed.
Well, and this wasn't necessarily like his first choice to go solo, right? This was more of a upset with the lineup of his band.
Is that? No, I think that's from earlier.
Is it? Okay.
That, I think. Am I right?
It gets confusing because there were, and we'll talk more about this when we get into the bio, but there were several instances where he had lineups of Adam and the Ants or the Ants, and they, for one reason or another, ended up getting pulled away from him. But this instance was just basically the lineup that he had dissolved. Like it just wasn't working anymore. This wasn't the other thing that I think you're thinking of, Sean, that we'll talk more about.
We're dropping so many hints for future content on this episode.
Yeah.
Everyone's the edge of their seats.
Well, So we can get into another song shortly here, but Rico, you said you've had this pretty much since it came out, and this was your introduction to Adam Ant. Have you gotten into much more from the catalog since then?
Oh yeah, all the stuff that you've been talking about. When I was in college radio, I didn't have access to all of it just because, you know, my local record store didn't necessarily have them all. But once I got into college radio, because I love this album, once I saw that they had all this other music, I was playing it, and especially Stand and Deliver, I remember playing a lot off of Prince Charming, which is not the album that people most... it's not probably people's favorite of his pre-solo albums, Adam and the Ants albums, but that song is really killer. And yeah, and they're all in the same vein. There's also, I mean, people who are fans of Adam Ant will know Ant Music. That was one of his early hits, which heavily features these drums and is like actually built much even more specifically around that kind of drum sound. But yeah, I love all that stuff.
Well, yeah, let's just get to another selection before we get into the bio and everything we've been alluding to. Up next, you had selected Here Comes the Grump.
Yes. This is a song I often have referred to it as my secret mixtape weapon. It was back when I was making mixtapes. Now I'm the father of a four-year-old and have no time for such dalliances. But that tune, it's one of those songs where you put it on and people, if they don't look at the lineup of your mixtape, they're like, oh, who's that track? And you're like, Adamant. And they're like, what? Because it's so smooth and it's kind of sweet sounding. I don't think that the lyrical sentiment is necessarily sweet. It might be. I like a lot of songs in this album. If you look at the lyrics too hard, you're like, what the hell is he talking about? I'm not sure that this is about anything. But it's almost Beatle-y. It's got this beautiful kind of like smooth, semi-acoustic Beatle quality. There's a George Harrison-esque crossed with rockabilly guitar solo. I just think it's like a great little pop number. And I'm dropping it here for everybody else to now steal from me for their mixtapes.
Passing it on.
Well, great. Let's listen to Here Comes the Grump, Side A, track 5. Yeah, that one just bounces along so joyfully for a song called Here Comes the Grump.
Yes, it's so amiable, isn't it? It's a. By the way, I did a little bit of research after I knew I was going to do this thing. This is one of those songs that it's like I never have been able to figure out. I still can't after doing this. But there was apparently a very short-lived animated series, I think in 1969 or 1970, that was called Here Comes the Grump. And there's no way that it can't be a reference to that, but I'll be damned if I understand what the song has to do with that show. It's like about a wizard. It was the voice of the wizard was voiced by Rip Torn.
Whoa.
I believe. And it was like a very silly little show about a wizard, but I don't like this seems like it starts out lyrically like it's a song about a guy. When you hit a number one, the only way is down. And if you have a sticky patch, they start looking around. So it sounds like it's about stardom, right? Once you get a number one hit, then you're going to plummet and people are looking for the next big thing. But then the next line is, the doctor said, Adam, sex kills, so come inside and die. What does that have to do? It's like, he's like, oh, yeah, that's right. I'm a sex symbol and a lot of my songs are about sex. I better throw in a verse about sex.
It makes it more clear that this is about me.
It's just a silly little song about a wizard.
That's right. Yes, it's very Dungeons and Dragons at that point, right?
We'll get right back to our discussion on Adam Ant in a moment, but we wanted to take just a little time to talk about our Season 5 Patreon push. This is our annual fundraiser where anyone who has signed up to our Patreon over at patreon.com/I'd Buy That Podcast by Sunday, March 31st, will receive exclusive I'd Buy That for a Dollar Season 5 swag designed by artist and illustrator Ellen Vandermeide.
I've never been so pumped to be sitting on the bench. Let me tell you that much.
Yes, the theme for this year's design is the I'd Buy That for a Dollar All-Star Team, and featured are four previously discussed musicians also known to have excelled in athletics. That would be
all right, let me see if I can guess them. Johnny Mathis.
Right.
Tammy Wynette.
Correct.
Charlie Pride.
You got it.
And Chris Christopherson.
Bingo. You're an all-star, Sean.
Thank you. Or at least a bench warmer.
Well, that's correct, because also featured are the I'd Buy That for a Dollar All-Star Bench Warmers. Co-host Sean, Jeremy, and Peter.
That's us.
So those signed up at the $1 tier, the early access tier, by March 31st, 2024, will receive a sticker of the All-Star logo. Those at the $5 bonus episode tier will receive the sticker plus a pin of the All-Star Bench Warmers. That's us. At the $10 tier, monthly mix tier, you'll get the sticker and pin plus a rad tote bag featuring the I'd Buy That for a Dollar All-Stars. And at the $25 tier, the vinyl subscription, patrons will get all of that plus a mug featuring both the I'd Buy That for a Dollar All-Stars as well as the bench warmers.
Yeah, you get all that swag plus the actual things you get for those Patreon tiers,
yeah,
which are like bonus episodes on 45s, our monthly mixes that we make based on the artists we feature that month, custom made by one of us hosts, and the vinyl subscription tier where Sean will lovingly select you your own dollar bin classic and send it along.
Along with a handwritten note. Very personal.
Yeah.
Personalized.
Yeah, you'd be crazy to not sign up, right?
That's right.
I just also want to clarify that all of this swag we have available is only available to people that sign up during this month. This is not stuff that's going to be available on a web store or available ever again. This is a very limited opportunity.
Yeah, these will not be cheap, inexpensive, and common things.
True. Collector's editions.
So you can sign up over at patreon.com/I'd Buy That Podcast. The designs are available to be viewed on our Instagram at I'd Buy That Podcast and on Facebook. Search I'd Buy That for a Dollar. Give us a like. Follow us. And with that, we return to our discussion on Adam Ant. Well, would we like to learn a little bit about who this Adam Ant guy is at this point?
Gee, would I?
He's probably a pretty normal guy with like nothing too interesting, I'm guessing, by the music.
Yeah, yeah. You think it's just kind of a ho-hum background?
Yeah.
Yeah, total square.
Well, he was born Stuart Goddard in a working-class part of London, England, on November 3rd, 1954, making him 1 year to the day younger than Dennis Miller. That's relevant, right?
Yes. All the context I need.
Speaking of Pittsburgh, I'm from Pittsburgh, so is Dennis Miller.
Oh, yeah. Wow. We talked a lot about Pittsburgh in the green room beforehand with Rico, because that's where Rico hails from.
The digital green room.
So Stuart was born into a working class family. He is of partial Romani descent, heritage that would inform a major theme in his work, a concern for oppressed minorities.
Hmm.
His parents divorced when he was 7, and his mother worked as a domestic cleaner and was employed by Paul McCartney. So a young Stuart Goddard, later to become Adam Ant, would sometimes go with his mother and walk McCartney's sheepdog, Martha, the inspiration for the Beatles song, Martha, My Dear.
What?
Yeah.
You are blowing my mind right now.
Yeah, he said that seeing all of the McCartney's home music room with all the psychedelic imagery was really inspiring to him when he was a youngster. While he was attending primary school, he created a stir by throwing a brick through the headmaster's office window 2 days in a row. And he was subsequently...
Once would be fine, but two, come on.
I want to make sure you get what I'm saying.
Yeah. He was subsequently placed under the supervision of a teacher who encouraged him to focus on his proclivity for art and creativity. And this quelled the hooligan in him, and by age 18, his art flair took him to art school to study graphic design. But ultimately, he kind of redesigned his interests while there. He joined a band called Bazooka Joe, which was a pub rock band founded by John Ellis, who would later go on to form the punk band The Vibrators, and a guy named Danny Kleinman, who would go to work in directing television commercials and music videos. He actually designed almost every James Bond title sequence since GoldenEye.
Wow.
Yeah. And our Stuart Goddard, later to be Adam Ant, played bass for Bazooka Joe. And that band is actually best remembered as the group who headlined the night that the Sex Pistols played their first show in November of 1975. The rest of Bazooka Joe did not like the performance. In fact, they had good reason not to like it. The Sex Pistols had borrowed their backline and started trashing it during their set. But Stuart saw the future of music and left Bazooka Joe, dropped out of college, and went off to pursue his own path in music, ant music.
Imagine having an opening band destroy your rig and then think, wow, I need to quit this band and start a new genre. These kids are onto something. That's not the takeaway I would have had from that gig.
I guess it's
a different time.
It's someone that would throw the brick 2 days in a row through the headmaster's window.
I can relate to this.
It is fascinating, though. I've talked to people that were around in England during that period of punk, and the way one guy put it to me was, he was like, when he saw the Sex Pistols, he was like, they didn't care. They didn't care about anything. They didn't care about what they looked like. They didn't care about themselves. They didn't care about the audience. And that was like a huge deal. Like, you just didn't behave that way in public, it feels like, at all, even in the slightest way.
Yeah.
So in a way, you can kind of get it. It's just like, wow, these guys are breaking every rule there is immediately.
Yeah. It's probably, in a lot of ways, it's very specific to the time and place that it was happening, but can also have some universal appeal.
Sure.
So Stuart adopted the stage name Adam Ant, and he took the name Adam because Adam was the first man, and he took Ant because if there is a nuclear explosion, ants are among the only survivors. There were different incarnations of Adam and the Ants. The lineup that appeared on their 1979 debut album, Dirk Wears White Socks, was soon whisked away by Sex Pistols manager Malcolm McLaren to form the band Bow Wow Wow. And this was after Adam had approached McLaren about managing the band. Can you guys imagine Malcolm McLaren doing something shitty like that?
Controversial.
Not at all. I'm sure it was a one-off.
And pretty amazing that Adam would still say that he liked the Sex Pistols after that.
Yeah, well, it's true. McLaren may have taken Adam's band, but not before giving him some fashion and imagery advice, albeit ripe with cultural appropriation. But this resulted in Adam and the Ants changing their look from a leather-clad S&M punk look to that of adventurous swashbucklers with touches of controversial Native American imagery. McLaren also introduced Adam Ant to the Burundi Beat, produced by a Central African group called the Royal Drummers of Burundi.
Yeah, and my understanding, by the way, is that it was like the way it went was that he gave Adam like a mixtape of all of this different music that he was into. And he was like, you know, if you want to be the future, you should be aping this kind of music in some way. One of them had the Burundi beat on it. and Adam and the Ants, like that was the thing that they could most kind of play with. He and the band were most able to work with that as a thing. They were starting to work up songs around that Burundi beat, and that's when McLaren goes like, you know what though? I think that this would be better without you, Adam. And that's when he's like, let's take the rest of the band, find Annabella Lwin, and create Bow Wow Wow. And so it's like the beginning of his band is basically a competition with Bow Wow Wow to be the first to get a Burundi beat single out
yeah.
in the UK.
What a strange competition. For those who don't know, Bow Wow Wow, their version of I Want Candy is their big one, their big hit.
And I love Bow Wow Wow, but I do feel like Adam Ant, his records stand up a little bit more. They're still really fun. I love to listen to Bow Wow Wow, but there's something a little extra about Adam Ant.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he carved his own path. And he didn't let McLaren's mutiny deter him. If anything, it fueled him. He formed a new lineup of Adam and the Ants, including guitarist Marco Peroni, who had worked with Susie and the Banshees prior. Peroni became Adam's writing partner, and the lineup now featured two drummers playing rhythms inspired by the Burundi beat. This combination proved fruitful as their next album, Kings of the Wild Frontier, produced several hit songs in the UK and started what we can call, and I think they called it at the time, Ant Mania. But they would only release one more album before disbanding. Apparently the band dynamic just wasn't there anymore. Adam wasted no time in launching a solo career, retaining Peroni as guitarist and co-writer. The two co-wrote and co-produced this entire album. Rico, you talked at the beginning about kind of the overwhelming amount of instrumentation that's coming at you on this. And the two of them, Adam Ant and Marco Peroni, played almost everything aside from the horns and drums on it.
Is that right?
Yeah, I was surprised when I saw just how much they're doing. The main drummer is a guy named Bogdan Wixling, who appeared on albums by Bill Wyman, Lena Lovitch, and Bill Nelson. But a lot of the percussion is Adam and Marco, aside from that.
How much is Adam doing? Because I think of Marco Peroni as being kind of like the musical genius, mainly because if you look at live performances from this era, for the most part, Adam is singing. He plays a little guitar, but you don't see him performing much else on stage, which isn't necessarily indicative of anything. But I didn't realize that he was really a multi-instrumentalist. In the Friend or Foe video, he's playing a trumpet, but I'm assuming that that's just for show. Mm-hmm. What else? He's really playing like the drums in this?
He is credited on various tracks, marimba, percussion, sticks, acoustic guitar, rhythm guitar, violin, triangle, and then brass arrangements and cover design, backing vocals.
It's really him. That's really cool. And gives me a lot more respect for him because it's not simple what's going on here in any way.
Oh yeah, it's pretty complex. There is actually a song named for Marco Peroni on here, and it sounded like you were interested in featuring that one, Rico.
Yes, it's called Man Called Marco. I mean, this was probably, for me as a teenager, my first exposure to spaghetti Western music sound. I wouldn't have called it that at the time. I might have made like a rockabilly connection or something, but this is like obviously a theme to a lost spaghetti Western and an instrumental. It's also just an unusual thing to have this like cool instrumental track. And I think it's the last track on the album, right?
It is. Yeah. It's a weird way to go out. Yeah, and we will hear a little spoken word bit from Marco.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
So, yeah, let's listen to Man Called Marco, Side B, track 6.
Thank you. the juice. My 507.
It's so great that him introducing his 507 is like one of the great moments in rock and roll for me. There is something about this whole album, actually. It really like changed my relationship to rock guitar, I think, because up until this period in my life, I'd been listening to a lot of things like, you know, hard rock and metal and arena rock and things like that, with a lot of like guitar solo, flashy guitar solos and wankery, which I still love and appreciate. But at the time, this album and also the Repo Man soundtrack made me realize that you could do equally kind of like powerful things with a guitar solo that was completely spare. There's another song on this, I can't remember which one, where Adam actually says, "Okay, Marco, let's see what you can do." And you expect a big flashy guitar solo, and he just plays chords really fast. There's no like notes or anything. He just plays a whole bunch of chords and it still kicks. And it was like, oh yeah, you can do a lot with a little, basically.
Less is more.
It's got that Pete Townsend influence going on, maybe.
The truth.
One thing I thought of with that song, I read that early on with Adam and the Ants, they used to tour with Susie and the Banshees a lot, which initially seemed like a strange pairing, but you listen to that song and it starts to make a little more sense.
He was in Susie and the Banshees.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Marco Peroni was in Susie for a while.
It all makes sense.
It's all coming together. Well, in 1983, during a U.S. tour, Adam Ant suffered a knee injury on stage, and during recuperation, he worked with Peroni on material for the sophomore solo album, Strip. In 1985, he performed at Wembley Stadium for the Live Aid benefit concert. He performed the title track from his third solo album, Viva La Rock. The organizer, Bob Geldof, later would say that Adam Ant was over the hill at this stage in his career, hence why they only allowed him one song. Adam Ant would respond by saying that participating in that concert was a mistake and a waste of time, and he felt that the event signified the end of rock and roll. So they're taking shots at each other.
Wow.
I watched his performance from that, and it's great. He was probably only rivaled by Freddie Mercury for energy. And
yeah, it's like over the hill. Like,
yeah.
half the bands on that lineup were like not young.
Yeah, it's a
when
strange.
You have a number one.
Yeah, true.
No truer words have ever been said, Adam.
So at this time, Adam put his musical career on pause to focus on acting. He appeared in several roles in film and television, including episodes of Northern Exposure, Amazing Stories, and Tales from the Crypt.
He was in the movie Slam Dance, too.
Yeah. Yeah, he had a number of film acting roles as well. It seems like it was a pretty serious pursuit. Meanwhile, Marco Peroni would go on to play with Sinead O'Connor on several albums, including her first two. So pretty major contributions to those albums.
Absolutely.
Since 1990, Adam Ant has released three more solo albums, and he has been very open about his struggles with mental health. He's been diagnosed with bipolar disorder and depression, and he's talked about how that has caused several setbacks in his career, going back to his very early days. And he's also talked about how his music has helped him cope. Yeah, so it's a big part of his identity. He has continued to perform and tour. In 2018 and 19, he undertook the Friend or Foe tour, performing this album in its entirety. The U.S. leg in 2020 of that tour was canceled due to the pandemic, but he will be touring the U.S. Midwest at the end of March 2024, and he'll be doing some dates on the East Coast in early April, coming right up.
Yes, indeed.
With special guest, The English Beat.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Another band that I loved in that time. And by the way, I feel like they belong together because both of them, I feel like Dave Wakeling and Ed Amant both similarly have a really great way of phrasing a lyric. They fit the words to the beat rather than caring how words are supposed to be emphasized or pronounced in a super cool way. Like in Friend or Foe, it's like, I want those who get to know me to become become admirers or my enemies, not to become admirers, to become admirers, because B is on the beat and it rocks. I don't know why, but Dave Wakeling similarly like does cool stuff like that. That's rad. I should check that out.
Yeah, the English Beater, another band that I've long wanted to feature on the podcast, because last I knew you could still get those records pretty cheap here.
Yeah. What happened? Definitely is a cheap one.
Well, speaking of which, Sean, I think it is at this time that we turn our attention to you.
Hmm. Okay.
And ask a question. Jeremy, do you remember what that question is?
Yes, I do.
Are you going to ask it?
I kind of want you to.
Okay, I can do that. Do you want me to do it now?
Yeah.
Okay. Sean, have you, by chance, put together a list of recommended similar albums for people to check out if they, for some reason, can't find Adamant out there in the bins?
You know, by sheer coincidence, I have done just that. I have three albums from 1982 and one from 1981. Here we go. First two we have mentioned before, Men at Work, Business as Usual, 1982.
Mm. We covered that one. Yeah.
Yeah. And then ABC, The Lexicon of Love.
Yes.
Another very theatrical band.
That's true. And also part of, would you consider them part of the new romantic movement?
I think so.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. They are, for those who don't know, all in the same vein of lush, good-looking guys singing sexy songs and wearing good clothes.
Yeah. Yep. And being a little bit quirky about it.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
Yeah. We talked about Men at Work with guest Mel Bell Smith, and we talked about ABC with guest Leora Haas. So check out those episodes if you haven't already.
Yeah. All right. Two more records that we have not done an episode about. Self-titled by the Flock of Seagulls, another 1982 record. Oh. And a band that for a long time was really kind of passed off as being a silly group not to be taken seriously. In the same way that I feel like a lot of people dismissed Adamant. But if you haven't gone back to those Flock of Seagulls records in a while, they are really good.
You want to talk about great guitarists. Mm-hmm. That dude broke some ground. It's amazing. And that first album is amazing.
And one more from 1981. If you love the quirky, weird art house influences of this, then look no further. Godly and Cream, Ism / Snack Attack from 1981.
Jeremy's scoffing. He's disgusted. I want Jeremy to think about the cover of Snack Attack right now.
No.
I have just a couple that I would like to add to that list, Sean. That,
please do.
Funny enough, were released in 1981 and 1982. Well, first of all, another one that we talked about really, really early on, the Human League Dare.
Mm-hmm. Oh, man. Great one.
And the other one I was thinking of is Wall of Voodoo, Call of the West.
You just, that's what I should have done. Screw Adamant. That album. That album is unbelievable. People only know that album from Mexican radio. And it is, I mean, that's actually a great crystallization of what they're like, but it is, they are geniuses, that band.
Yeah.
That album is a genius record.
Yeah. It's incredible. I was really surprised when I first gave it a listen front to back about 15 years ago. I was really astounded by the depth, the musical depths, and plus the lyrics of Stan Ridgway are like, there's just nothing quite like them.
No, absolutely. The title cut, Call of the West, is like a dark, dark look into the soul of America. It is amazing. And if you can find, there's a live video of them performing that song in a club at the time. And it's like amazing. They're like lit from below. And you, again, talking about spaghetti Western guitars, that band just like ate them for breakfast. It was amazing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, their performance at the US Festival is also a great thing to watch. It can be found on YouTube.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Although I must say, I think I thought of that album to pitch to you guys, and I think I looked it up on Discogs, and I think it's a little too expensive.
It's gotten a little pricier nowadays. It used to be something you could find for $5, $7. I've noticed that, too, that it's been going up in recent years.
I think you're looking at a 12 or maybe a 15.
Yeah, that's the times we're in now. Well, Sean, thank you so much for those recommended similar albums. Rico, while you're here, would you like to plug anything that you have going on, what you're up to, where people can find you?
Sure. I would love folks to listen to the Mubi podcast. That is MUB as in boy, I podcast. We are not a movie chat show. We're a documentary style show that tells stories behind great movies, a lot of times with the help of the actual filmmakers. And I guess I would direct listeners of this show to our third season, which is from last summer, and it is all about great needle drops in films. And we talked about the use of Tears for Fears in the movie Donnie Darko. Director Richard Kelly was on that episode. We talked about the Cantopop cover of The Cranberries' Dreams that was in the movie Chungking Express. For that one, we had one of the guys who wrote the movie's score. We talked to John Hughes, music supervisor for Ferris Bueller's Day Off. There are great stories behind all these songs, so go listen to those, and you can find us wherever pods are cast. And also, enjoy life. I would like to plug that.
Aw.
That's a good thing to remember to do.
Yeah. Thanks.
Well, yeah, thank you so much. It was a lot of fun to learn more about Adam Ant, and this album was pretty new to me overall, and I feel like I've expanded my knowledge of his catalog and some of the stuff connected to it. Hopefully that is the same case for our listeners.
And for me too. Paul McCartney.
Yeah, Paul McCartney Sheepdog.
Who knew?
So we are going to have to play one more selection to get out of here. We have to do it. Rico, what did you want to play as we get out of here?
I chose the song. It's not even necessarily my favorite song. It's just the weirdest. It's called Cajun Twister, which it's a band that clearly they're interested in, you know, African drumming and American soul. Basically, they were interested in anything that wasn't kind of like straightforward Englishism, I feel like. And I feel like in this song, they were kind of like, well, what's another interesting culture that we could throw in here? Cajuns. All right. And so it's this kind of Cajun sounding tune. I've looked at the lyrics many times. I'm not sure what it's about, but it's kind of funky. So let's dig it.
Yeah, obviously that element of the band has not aged well. I think it was even controversial in the early 1980s, but now 40 years removed, it's definitely a little cringy, some of that stuff. Mm-hmm. But they made some incredible music, and this one actually I got a little bit of a Clash vibe from it, like maybe they'd been listening,
yeah, Sandinista. Kind of Sandinista era.
Yeah, I was thinking they'd been listening to some Sandinista.
Oh, that's fascinating. Yeah, that could actually be the case, except that was being used to make a political point, generally speaking. And here I'm not quite sure that there's any real point, other than that it sounds different.
Yeah. There definitely are songs in his catalog that seem a little more pointed towards making statements, but I think you're right that's not happening here. So yeah, Cajun Twisters, we'll get out of here on that. Thank you so much for listening to I'd Buy That for a Dollar. My name is Peter Cook.
I'm Jeremy Ruggles.
I'm Sean Hartman.
And I'm Rico Galliano.
watching them.